And it's the time we wait for every year. We're going to try to make this plane a one-piece plane in the very, very near future. This is probably the most exciting part of building any plane, getting it all put into one piece. This is one of those pictures that everybody that comes to the cellar says, yeah, make up a caption. Yeah, I'm cool, I'm cool. Come on, make up a caption. Yeah, I'll make up a caption, Wendy. Now we've come to, close to the day. Actually, it's not going to be today, it'll be tomorrow. We were actually going to turn this into either a one-piece plane or get most of that done. One of the things, if you're going to do an accurate alignment, you need a flat table. A table that, in my case, I use a door that's on a dresser that has a piece of glass on top of it. And then what I tried to do is if that glass, and I'm trying to do this relatively accurately, if this little piece of glass isn't exactly true, and you can true it up with a string, you want to shim the middle with IBM cards. In this case, you can use IBM cards, but the way to get the alignment in the table, if this is the top of the glass, is you stretch a string from corner to corner, have somebody help you, pull a string tight, and see if you have a bow in the table, if from the side it has the bow going this way, or if it's a bow going this way. If it's a bow going this way, the string is going to be tight and you're going to need to put some shims in the middle of the table. And obviously you can figure out that when you take that string and you can't slide an IBM card without seeing the string move, you've got it pretty close. If you're within the thickness of an IBM card, I'd say that's real good. If you're in this mode and the string really is stretched in this mode, you're going to have to put IBM cards in the corner. But ultimately, to wind up with that along the whole length of the string in both dimensions, you can't slide an IBM card onto any of these stations, and it's relatively flat. Now, in my own table, in fact, as I'm doing this, I'm looking down and I see the IBM cards from last year's alignment. Getting the table lined up and getting it scraped clean is usually step one. Now let's pretend we're really, really pro stunt and we really have a perfectly true table. Notice I'm using a ruler, very professional. Anyway, once we know the table is flat, I'm going to take the body of the Seafire and I'll do this. See, I'm trying to do this on camera here because doing it in real life is really a little bit on the sloppy side. You don't really see as well as you can't point out the things I'm trying to point out. I let the nose ring hang off the end of the table and I will have my fuselage here. Again, boy, this is not, I'm glad I'm not in an art class. Yeah, I have the wing cut out anyway. I also am going to have, again, I'll use a ruler here just to show how pro stunt this can be. In fact, I'll try to make it to scale. I have a line that's already scribed on the fuselage. So if I was doing better drawings, if I knew what the hell I was doing, this would look something like this. Okay, but you get the point. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to carefully measure this dimension. I know the table is flat and carefully measure here. And if I need any sanding, if I need anything, remember this is my true edge. This is the true edge. Everything is going to be in alignment to the top of this table. So I want the wing, when the wing is in alignment, when this piece of course is cut out, I want to have both of those center lines referencing off the table, these to be exactly the same. That's my goal here, is to get these two the same. Now once that's all set down, I'm going to tack glue this to the table. I try not to tack glue under the wing because then when I go to break it off, it's difficult to break it off. Just a few tacks of glue along the whole body, and then I'm going to, on about a 20 degree angle back, cut this piece on a, if you look from the top, the angle would be this way crooked and this way on an angle. It's a double bias cut. This makes for putting a piece in a lot better of a joint. If you get this picture, you only really have to see this once. This piece then will be removed, and when I lay the wing in, I can trim it here, I can trim it here. I can trim it here. Wherever I have to get this alignment so that the wing itself now has a center line on it and a center line. And I can get this center line and this center line. By floating these two together, I can get a real accurate wing position. And this is the first part of this whole thing. Once that wing is then glued in, and I'll try to use real slow drying glue so I have about an hour to work with it, that part is done. I glue this piece back in and glue that joint, make the doublers up. Again, I've done this a zillion times, so I know just about how this should go. And now I have good integrity. This whole outline of the fuselage has the carbon fiber, that thread, the toe, whatever you want to call it. So now that should, in theory, hold the alignment when I break it off the table, flip it over, and do the tail alignment. And that's the easiest, best way I know to do it. Tips that'll make this real easy for you. Dedicate a day. Now, it's late in the day today, and I wouldn't start doing this at 5 or 6 o'clock at night, or 7 o'clock, or when you're tired, or when you're having a hangover, or when you had a late night with the go-go girls or anything. What you want to do is get up early in the morning, have a couple cups of coffee. Now, dedicate this day, because in one day, you can do that whole fuselage thing, flip it over, get the tail in, get the push rod in. Usually, that's a whole day, and a dedicated day. So if you dedicate a day to putting the plane in one piece. Now, Lou Dudkin and Glenn Metter, when they used to do it, we'd all try to get together and dedicate a day. I'd go to Lou's house, I'd have the wing and tail and everything, and we'd dedicate a day to putting that plane together. Now, I also want to emphasize, if this is the fuselage and you lay the wing in, you really need to make sure that this corner and this corner, I usually make up a little template. In fact, I already have one made up from the Spitfire, which we'll probably do, so that in effect you don't have the body, when you look from the top, the body either offset that way or offset this way. And measuring this angle here, there's two ways to do this real easily since you have plywood. It's not a good idea to do the back. It's a good idea to this, a little piece of plywood or balsa. It'll be always a little more than 90 degrees. And if it's equal on both sides, you know you have a real good shot that the wing is now in at dead 90 degrees. Another way, now I don't do it this way, but Lou used to do it this way, is he'd take the point of the wing and measure these two pieces with either a ruler, a 48-inch ruler or whatever. So from the tail post to the corners of the wing would be equal, and then you could get your final little alignment that way. See, the point is, it really doesn't matter how you do it. What matters is that you get the wing in so that these two planes, the hinge line and the center of the fuselage, are kind of on a 90-degree angle. And if you get those two, you're really in good shape. Now, just as an example, if you have the hole cut for the wing, and you've got the center line scribed on, and now that wing, you really want to have it that there's just, maybe a 64th of clearance, and I'm overdoing this, all around it, so that you can, I'll call it float for a better word. You can get that final little thickness of a pen line, thickness of a pencil line. You can get these two points lined up in the front. If it's oversized, what you need to do is the equivalent of sheetrock work. You need to find a hard spot or where it's hitting so that you can get that wing to just drop down, drop down, drop down, and sit in. Now, it's easier for me to show this like this than it is to do it on a when the wing is in the body, it's hard to focus up and you really can't see, well, what the hell's he trying to do here? But if you have this just a little bit of clearance, you can go back and forward, up and down, and get that bottom joint where it's in solid epoxy, a nice solid joint. Now when you drop the top on, you can just cut sand or whatever, or just fill this in, even with a little piece of balsa scrap, it doesn't matter. But to get the wing attached to that bottom of the body that's glued to the table, what that means is you have that wing in parallel to the top of the table, and the motor mounts are parallel to the top of the table, and when you turn it over, that same edge is going to be the edge of the stab. You have got all your alignment in one stroke of the pen, in one day, in one shot, and you should be very, very confident that you can get it, that it's right. And just to mention this too, while we're talking about alignment, when you look from the top, if this is the fuselage, and we'll make a straight wing so it's a little more, same thing for an elliptical wing. You can reference off what I'm saying, because these are things that'll help even an advanced level flyer get right. You really, these are the things you'd like to have significantly right. When you measure hinge line to hinge line, that's a critical dimension. If that dimension is off more than a 16th of an inch, if the wing is in this way and the tail is in that way, and I'll exaggerate it, or if it's this way, you can imagine the stab and elevators are going to act similar to a rudder to turn the plane in at you or turn it out. You'd really like to have, in an all-perfect world, you'd like to have that dimension so that, and I always measure from the tip. I get myself a ruler, and I measure from the tip of the hinge line, measure from the tip of this hinge line, and I want these two guys to be exactly equal. I really want to spend any amount of time necessary to get that part of the alignment. That is a critical part. Now, because the Seafire and the Spitfire both have a flat tail. A flat tail means we're just going to use the top of the body, which we know is parallel to the table. It's going to just sit on there. It's going to have a little taper up in the front. But we don't have to worry about making that alignment. In the case of, if you're doing, let's say, a Cardinal where the tail sits in the body and it usually has the piece cut out for it, what you need to do is get a reference line from the center to the top. And you need to do the same as if that was a wing, shim the bottom, shim the top, shim wherever you can. But having that flat stab and elevator, it's almost foolproof. You drop it in, make sure it's flat, measure hinge line to hinge line, tack it in place, and you're ready to go. So having a flat tail does make the alignment part of this about an hour or two easier. So, okay, with no further ado, tomorrow is going to be alignment day, and I'm going to clear the bench, shim the table, and get all the parts ready to go. And we'll get back here tomorrow with some coffee in our belly and now, before I actually get ready for alignment day here, spending a little time. I got a real accurate reading here, and I'm at 4, I guess 418 would be a fair number. That would include all the blocks, the flaps, all the hinges. The hinges will get trimmed by about 4 or 5 grams. All the cannon tubes and blisters and everything that's going to go on here. And that whole thing comes out to be 14.8, a little under 15 ounces for the wing in silver. That's about, well, it's a little on the heavy side by about a half an ounce of what I expected, but all that'll mean is when I get to some of the other details here, I'll have to really be careful not to pile a paint on. It's always easy to make up a little bit of the weight, easier to make it up in paint than it is in balsa wood, that's for sure. Okay, what I did this morning off camera, because it does take quite a bit of time, I got this table all shimmed up, and you can see it really, what happens is the wood underneath it seems to get a little bellies and whoop-de-doos in it, but let's hope it's perfectly straight now. And since I'm basically only going to be working off that edge, that's the only edge I'm really worried about right now. I also took the scraper, got off any of the little flakes or chunks, Windex it all down. You can see how scratched that table's getting from years and years of wear. And we'll get ready to start putting that wing in the body. Now, an alternative, years ago that Jim Greenaway used to tell me about, that'll work almost, or maybe works just as well as this. He used to find a piece of 2x4 or 4x4 that had one really flat side, or have it machined flat, I guess you could do that, or block sanded flat, because we're really only going to use one strip of this table. But I always do like to make sure, even after I do it with the string, I always like to sight it. I don't know, there's something about sighting things that when you sight, in fact, you know, even after shimming it, this looks like it could use one less card here. This is the kind of stuff that makes you crazy.
Come on, get out of there.
Now, I did shim this, and yeah, it looks better. Even this amount, I don't want to have this much of a bow built in or whatever. I want this as accurate as possible. Another way to check this, I have the ruler from Midgley. And this is a steel machinist ruler that has a really good edge. Since this is the area we're going to be using, again, it's really reasonably straight here.
Now, I fooled around with this. You can see all these gings, or whatever you want to call it, from years and all these scratches, years and years of working on this table. Now, one of the things I decided to do, and I guess every once in a while this would be a good idea, I've really, in, I guess, what, 5, 6 years, I've only used one side of this table. So what I'm trying to do, I took everything off of the table, and I'm going to scrape all this crap off, clean the table up real nice and clean, and try rotating it, because that side of the table has no wear and tear on it, and this side is all scratched and chipped and chunked. And I figure, hey, if you're going to do this at the end of a year, or 2 years, or 5 years, this is, you know, how you rotate a mattress. This is not a bad time to do it right now, being we're ready to do the alignment. And I fooled around with shimming it and everything. It looks like the glass is still pretty decent, but that one side has some terrible wear and tear on it. A lot of models have been built on this table.
Now, after all these years, I'm surprised I didn't think of this sooner. After just looking at how beat up that glass was and thinking about, boy, if there's one thing you don't want to shortchange, is the day you put the plane together. You don't want to have that be a day that all kinds of things are going wrong and you're under the gun and everything. Even though this table still shims pretty straight, the one side of it is really ratty, and I keep thinking, well, yeah, I'll do that at the end of the season. Well, you know what? I'm glad I'm inspired here to do this now, because this will make aligning it all up a whole lot nicer and neater, and for sure more accurate. And you can see this table really has taken a beating. But it's been, I guess, I had this even at the other shop, so it's more than 5 years. Now, acetone is always the best thing for doing a final cleaning on this. Even the table underneath it's dirty. And maybe that's a lesson, maybe that's something I should have thought of before. This is like routine maintenance, like changing the oil in your car or putting new control lines, a new cable in your handle. You skimp on this, I don't know, you could be paying for a long time to come. Anyway, I'll get this. What I'm going to do first is I'm going to try flipping it over and see what the other side is. If the other side is nice and neat, yeah, well, fine. But before I flip it over, I want to get all this gummy stuff. This could be where we had the sanding belts glued down to the table. Now, there's a couple of benefits right now. First off, I tried flipping this over and I forgot I have these little etched lines on one side. I didn't want to have those on the top. But what I have now is a perfectly flat. I mean, there isn't a glitch in this side of the table. The other side is all chewed up. And this is the part where I'll put my boxes and things. So this worked out to be, of course, I'm going to re-shim this now. Just looking for any little glitch in the table. But it seems like you spend a lot of time doing this. Well, you spend an hour or two, but the result is every time you pull out of a wing over, it's flat instead of dump 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 dump. Hey, what is dump 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 anyway? And now, of course, reshimming this. It should be relatively quick. This is the part of the table I'm going to use, and I want to have most accurate. Now, what I do, I read the amount that this is down, and I almost can do this ahead of time by taking IBM cards. See, two IBM cards don't fit in there. Let's see if one is sloppy. So it's probably about 7,000. So I'll put two, knowing that in time, pressure is going to push this down. Two cards will probably be just the right amount. Again, right now I'm only concerned with this corner of the table. This is a 10-foot long table, so the other 6 feet or so right now don't have to be perfect. Only out in this corner I want perfect. Now, I can't push that side of the ruler down. Whoops. And again, this is not an aluminum ruler. This is not one of those Home Depot rulers. This is a a very accurate machinist ruler. Thanks to Dave Midgley for this. It was some kind of a Christmas present. Okay, for now that's shimmed. I want to put all my stuff back up on the other end of the table, and we'll be ready. Now this is the beat-up side of it. Oh, Jesus, you can even hear it. The beat-up side of the table. Now what I did in the past, and this was an idea you guys, anybody, might want to use. I used to always leave these boxes just laying on the table, and then what would happen is some guy would come along like me with a big belly and boom, boom, everything would be off the table. So what I do now, I take a roll of duct tape and make little circles of duct tape and get each thing glued down in position, so just so it kind of holds it there if somebody bangs into the table, or we've had other a little accident, somebody goes around with a wingtip and boom, all the razors are on the floor. Now I used to use, this is years ago and this is funny too, I used to have the same problem and I'd solve it by using silicone on everything, GE clear silicone. What would happen is when you go to take it off, holy mackerel, you had to scrape for 2 hours to get the thing clean. So rather than go through that, the duct tape is a much better way. It really does hold it in position. You'll see in 1 second what I'm talking about. And I always have a block of wood for my razors. If I lay that down there, somebody walks by now, it doesn't go flying on the floor. Then you can put the rolls of tape, you can kind of line it up. If you want to be cute, you can make little labels for things. Cheap and easy. Oh, another nice little idea I usually do is I put a little bit of a block of wood right on the corner of the table. Obviously a piece of scrap balsa wood. Once that kicks off, what I can do is, this is a good way to store razors they don't have, or knives or whatever. This was part of what I wrote about in Model Aviation, my cute little bench article. Anyway, got a lot of good response from that, from basically from RC people that hadn't thought of some of this little stuff. This is a nice, neat way to store stuff. See, any kind of little container, I don't know, I think it helps you keep things organized anyway. All right, that was worth a little time. You know, it's always, to me anyway, a good idea. Get things organized. These little boxes and things always seem to get me in a mood to do good work, or as good as possible work. Now I have that end of the table scraped, cleaned, shimmed, wiped, cleaned, whatever, diapered, who knows what else, and I'm ready. At last. I think this was one of the good investments here, though. Now before I even glue this down, I want to check with the ruler just to see that we haven't had anything warp. You know, we're in a humid cellar. It does look bad. Now what I usually like to do is line the center of the fuse up on one of these, whatever you want to call them, etched lines. In fact, I'll move in just enough so I can walk around this side and not disturb the wing. After fooling around and shimming everything, I came up with, I don't know if this is really the easiest way to do it, but these are those epoxy scrapers, and they have a complete taper to them. So what I've been doing, I just was looking for a little bit of a better way to do this than the IBM cards, and this really did work well. What I did is I just insert that in, laid a ruler on top, and then tap it in until that end of the table comes up to the height I want. It's an infinite taper, so it's really easy to get everything laid out. And what I did, I checked it with the ruler, and when I laid out the fuselage, wow, it was almost perfect on the first shot. So now, if I wanted a little more height here, I could just press the, I don't want to touch it now, it's on good adjustment. And what I'm going to do, I think, in the future is order a dozen or so of these so I can place them at any spot around a table. And what I did, I ripped out all the IBM cards, and just using these, it was a lot easier. So see, even doing this time after time, you come up with a little better way each time you do it. Of course, the best way of all, if you make a table, See how this table sits out over the edge? What happens as time goes by is the weight starts to pull it down. So what would be perfect here, of course we don't have it, would be to have a leg out on the end of the table. Well, what I had at one time, I had a 4x4 out there, and it was really inconvenient. Every time you'd walk by, you'd trip on it. But what would really be a help in the future is if I move this dresser all the way over, and I'm going to think about doing this, and then at the side of the table I don't use, let this end drop down. See, the way I have it now, it's not really the way it should be, is the dresser should be almost out at the end on one side, so you could use that one side of the table and it wouldn't constantly need these shims to get it back into level. Just some ideas that may help you get that table level. That's so important. See, this really did make a nice fit. It was worth that extra time. Just a couple of tacks of glue here. But well, you don't want to have it that you press it down, it's like a banana, or that it's rocking or shaking. Okay. Now, again, one of the tricks is never put glue under the wing, because then you can't get under there and break it loose. And just a couple of tacks, just enough to hold it in place. If it breaks loose, you can always glue it back down. I like to look and see that. I guess you can do it by eyeball just as good, that I have a real good joint right along the table.
Yeah, eyeball is the best at making sure that that's totally flat right against the table before you start. Now what I need to do is I need to make up a little block of wood or a machinist ruler or something and check that this dimension to the table and the one in the back to the table and the two on this side, that they're all exactly the same. The next step, and I know this seems like it's getting overly involved and overly accurate, but believe me, this is the one thing on a whole plane it's really worth spending some time on. And any kind of, I've had jigs and fixtures and machinist rules, but what I really want to be able to do is reference this line to the table on all four points. That's super, super important. I'm doing, I'm making up a poor man's fixture, and this will only take a minute to make. I'm taking a number 11 blade and just pushing it in. Now the idea here is I can get this lined up at the point that all four are equal. I can CA that in. This gives me a nice little relief, so I don't have to worry about bumping up to the edge, and I've got a little taper in it this way. So this is really like a poor man's, and it's just a block of spare balsa wood. 2 minutes and you have it. Now the purpose is, when this lays flat, you need a flat surface. You can't make this on the end of a toothpick or something, because you don't want to have it that it does that or that. You want it to constantly ride nice and flat. Now the nice thing is you can kind of just fine tune this. In fact, I want to push this down just a little bit, push it all the way in. I don't want it sitting out in midair. It's got to come up. And of course, what's really neat about this is you can cut your finger a lot of times if you're not careful. So the fact that you're working, there we go, that with a razor, it tends to make it that you get real careful in a hurry. As soon as you poke this under your fingernail a few times. Okay, now, once I get that set, it's a good idea before you do this to take a little alcohol and clean the blade too. You get a little idea of just just how you can measure that right along. Go down to the next. Remember, the key is that it lays flat. You don't have this or that. We're going to use this to check all the center lines. For the rest of referencing this up, that'll be the gauge for this alignment for the rest of this time that we're lining this up.
Now, the thing here to do is to cut it on a pie slice angle. Don't cut it at a 90 degree angle. Try to maintain whatever angle it is you start with. And of course, the trick here would be to have a decent zona saw, which we don't have. This one is dull as can be from sawn metal or whatever we were doing with it. A brand new blade would have been nice to have. But to get that pie slice in there, it's that pie slice that allows you to put it back so that the joint doesn't crack later on in the life of the plane. We're sawing right through plywood and carbon here, so it takes a little time. Just a nice little bit. Now, that the fact that it's held down to the table really does make this a little easier than it normally would be.
See, the fact that that's on an angle, like a pie slice, a slice of bologna, when you join this back, you have about three times the amount of glue area as if you had a 90 degree cut. So you not only have that angle going back, you also want to have the angle on one side. And if you need to practice that, it's a good idea to practice on some old scraps of wood before you cut the fuse. Same thing in the back here. I want to cut a pie slice. I'm going to cut right through the carbon. Same thing on this side and on this side, and then I can take that piece right out. Now, it's just one easy way of doing this is to hold a machinist ruler. Obviously, these were finished with these. These were just in here to hold the fuselage while we did the work on it. I'm just truing this edge all up as much as I can. Make sure that's a little high spot there. Now, we don't need these formers anymore. I want to just salvage the sides. This will all get remade new when this is finished. I just want to break them out very carefully and then get all the glue off of them. Now, when we go to put these back, these will be all kind of cleaned up. All we'll have to do is make the little spacers and doublers. Now, on the wing, what Joe does, and I sanded off a little bit of the silver, he puts a toothpick, and this is a good way to do it, right in the center, right on the center line, so that from that toothpick now I can use a reference and run a ruler out on each side and get a center line on the center of the wing. Real important to have that. Without that toothpick in there, or if you have a line and you sand it away, you're kind of lost. But once that toothpick is in there, you can always sand down. Let's see if I can get this. You can see the toothpick right there. And as soon as you hit through the silver, you can see that the hardwood is a little different color. Now you can just scribe on a center line.
Okay, now what I did, I put a little piece of tape on each side, just roughly, so I didn't wind up putting a center line way out to one side. put a towel out here because you can see there's a rough edge on the glass just to protect the wing. And actually, I should put something over there if I can find another old towel. Just to protect the wing, so in the course of putting this in and out 100 times, I don't wind up dinging it all up. Now, the other thing is, you can see where the push rod is hitting some of the formers. I have to channel that out, make a little channel so that wing can lay in there and I can start getting some test fits on it. Now you can take a little test fit, and you know, little by little, you can just take a little more off each time until you get a nice fit in there. See, this is the part that may get frustrating, is you just go back and forth until you get the fits that you want. And it's probably, this is why you allow a dedicated day for this. I can just pick up any spot where it's hitting and just... I know this is the high spot where it's hitting. Good idea to keep this point here. There's a point where this cut ends, at least radiused a little bit, because otherwise it pokes 100 little holes in the side of the wing, or top of the wing. Here's one little thing that I always find helpful when I'm getting to this point, is I just do a rough alignment. I just roughly get these two sides at 90 degrees, and then I want to see the horn. See the same amount of clearance on each side of the horn. This is just roughly. Now I know this tape will protect this from getting too chewed up, even though it's already chewed up a little bit, from taking it in and out and in that, bumping on a table, bumping on this and that, whatever. It also gives me a rough idea of exactly where that wing is going to lay in there. Now, when I get down, and I need to take a close look now at, see, the wing is in what I call, what I did on that little dissertation bureau. It floats. I can move it forward, I can move it back, I can move it side to side. And what I need to do is make enough clearance that I line up all these points. Now I can see right now this is a little bit high. When I look at this side, you see how the wing is high? I need to get it down. So I need to see what it's rocking now. Now when it's rocking, it probably means everything is okay, but it's like a rocking horse. Somewhere under there's a high spot and it's rocking back and forth. And if I can find that high spot either by looking at it or just by feeling where it is, I can just keep removing the high spot, taking it in, taking it out, taking it in, taking it out. Now from the back it looks like, just a rough idea of how it looks like I'm high, so there's definitely somewhere in that bow there's a high spot, and I'll get in there carefully, and even if I have to do it 40 or 50 times is to take that little bow out. Now just looking for the high spot, just like you're doing laying in a piece of sheetrock. I don't know if you can see the high spot here. What I'm trying to do is pick up right about 6 inches in front here. You can see it just hits on one spot before all the others. And that's what I've been doing, is just shaving that away little by little. When you get down to the final few swipes here, it's very difficult. We're only a couple of sandpaper swipes away. What you can do is take a piece of carbon paper. This is just ordinary carbon paper. Put the wing back in roughly the way it should be. Try to get it as close as possible. Give it a little rub back and forth. You can actually see, I think this would be good to focus in on. You can actually see this. See the lines it leaves on here? So that's giving you a clue where it's rubbing. Also, once you take the paper away, you can see it leaves a little bit of a scratch on there anyway. Get that the last little bit out, and then just keep repeating over and over. Put the paper back in, pick up a high spot, sand it off. Eventually, one by one, it'll settle right down into the cradle. Now, I pretty much have everything roughed in. The center lines are within a pencil line. Dust everywhere here. Now, what I do, the next thing, but because we're going to have some kind of a little complex fillet work here, I took two pieces a quarter inch and just kept sanding each one until it was kind of a press fit. So that'll kind of hold that in position. And what that does, that gives us the alignment in the back. And I know pretty much where that has to be. Now what I need to do is just shimmy and shake the front until both of these angles are equal. And what I'll do is I'll make up a balsa template and then make sure both sides are pretty much the same, and then I'll mark everything so I know I can get my marks back when I go to put the glue on this. Now I'm going to take one side, sand the paint off in the middle, and then just interpolate the tape lines over and do the other side. This will just give me a little bit better grip onto the glue, the epoxy that I'm going to use. Also, I want to draw some alignment lines on here, and it'll be make it a little bit easier to get the lines in straight. And also, it'll kill about a 1/1 millionth of a grain, which is real significant. Now, whatever alignment we still have to do here is going to be very minor. That'll hold us in position there. And we're out by the cannon hole, about a 1/16 of an inch. You know, I eventually made up a little template so that I can see if these angles are both equal. In fact, this is one I used on Strega already. And when you have the angles equal and all the center lines lined up, that's ready to glue. And just give that just a little shift. And this is why I allow a dedicated day to get this first glue joint in. I don't want to be thinking about other things. And okay. Wow, that's close. Okay, now that I have that, at least for a reference, I'll put a line in here. This is for my reference. And a reference on the inside here. Okay, now once I go back, and boy, I know this gets boring, but those lines are all in good alignment. At the same time all those lines are in alignment, I want to make sure I'm right on the center line of the horn. Oh, you can't really see it with the camera. I want to be right in the middle of the wire, and at the same time all that's happening, I have my alignment going right down the middle of the fuse. And we're ready. Mix up some slow drying epoxy. Get this set in, and then this is going to pretty much sit overnight while we get some other stuff done. Now, I always think the best thing, because I'm going to let this dry overnight, so it really won't matter. But the best thing of all is always give yourself the extra working time. Even if you were going to come back and work on this later in the day, you really don't want to have 5-minute epoxy here. And I like to use the kind where one tube is twice the size of the other.
This gives me about a half an hour of where I can pull it apart if something isn't lined up. And I usually like to take that whole time to do what I call babysitting and just keep walking around, checking my alignment, checking everything. It's really, the minute you have something drying in a hurry, you know something's going to go wrong and you're going to be crazy. So I'll try to give myself every opportunity here. I'll have about a half hour to babysit this. And then by letting it dry overnight, when I come back to it, I hope this will all be kicked off real, real nice. And like with any epoxy, the trick is even after you think it's well mixed, keep mixing it. Flux brush is handy for this. Certainly not super critical, but... And the trick here is to get a nice even bead. And what I'm going to do is drop the wing down as carefully. That's why I have all those marks on it to make sure it's centered. Carefully have it centered. And then pull it back out and make sure I have a clean bead around the whole thing. See what 5 minute you run into while you're rushing and rushing and rushing after all that work, after a whole day of getting this to reel it where it's a precision fit, then you jeopardize it by having quick drying epoxy. And get rid of some of the stuff on the edge. And keep in mind, one of the things that's not really important is to have a real super, super, super tight fit. You can have little gaps. Little gaps can be filled in. It's not a problem. Now what I want to do is pull it out and see that I've caught a good amount. Now see, I'm missing a little spot here at the back. Let me just lay this here. You know, any epoxy that kind of oozes out here. In fact, I got some over here. And get rid of that. This is why I like to have a little extra working time. Let me get that alignment. And my front is real good. Front is real good. It's so good, in fact, that it's pushing out all the epoxy. And I'll just hold the wing in position temporarily. Now I can go around and readjust, get a final tweak on all my lines, and I see this one's out half a pencil line. Take my shims and check that the back is still nice and straight. On a center line. Once I know I'm on it, ooh, yes. Once I know I'm on a center line, I can use these wedges just to hold this into position. Okay, that holds that. And that's lined up. At the same time that is, at the same time that is, and I'm on center. Okay, we got that one. And I'm right in the middle of the horn. And what I do to check that
Let's see if we can do this. Let's just pull the shim away on one side. Check that you're right in the middle. That'll kind of set it in position.
Do a little walk around, make sure all my little lines mark up. And that's pretty much going to be it for today. We'll put this away. Tomorrow when I come back, this will just be all set to go. I'll just let that cook, all the lines line up. And that is really, that is a reasonably good alignment there. Now in today's mail, two really neat things. Nice ship from Raul Torres in Brooklyn. And I will pass this along to Stunt News, of course. Looks like a Geesky Nobler. And he says he's going to be trying to stop by on, Monday night, one of these Monday nights. We look forward to having a session with you, Raul, and bring something to work on. Now, this is a little sketch of nose art that Pat Johnson is working on. I don't know if this is X-rated or what. Anyway, Pat's going to use some of those exhaust stacks on his P40, and we'll be looking forward to getting a picture soon. Okay, that epoxy's been drying overnight, and I guess we're pretty much ready to start fitting in the bottom pieces. We're going to take a look around, make sure there's nothing moved. Of course, always check all the center lines, that everything remained the same. And if something moved, you're out of luck, baby. Cut it apart. Anyway, it looks pretty decent. Looks pretty much ready to go. We can pull out these little shims, get the weights off. And we're pretty much ready to start fitting in those top pieces. Now even with the weights removed, it's a good idea to just double check everything. Well, you never can double check too many things. Looks like we've kind of lucked out. Everything stayed right on track. Now you can see when you just lay that piece in, it's usually a little bit too high. Like just zero in on it. So what I'm going to do is just take a sanding block and just gently sand that in until we get a really nice tight fit, especially up in the front where it's really going to matter. Back here it's important, but not as important as getting that whole front to be nice and solid. That's where the torque of the motor is going to come through, and we want to try to capture it right up to that wing spar, that all those firing impulses will be transmitted right out through the wing spars. Way of making this just a little bit easier is I can kind of pick up the high spots with a pen line. You can see the little line just gives me a little reference line where the hard points are. Now we just do a little test fit, a little dry fit again. Now I can see right now where just where the dark spots are, right up in the front a little bit more. Now in the end you can just take little tiny shavings off to get that fit as good as you possibly can. And no matter what you do now, there's always going to be a gap at the back. So what we're really trying to do is get the front to be a good joint, and then we'll fill in the back with scrap. See, the only thing I'm concerned with now is getting this front joint nice and straight. And we're closing in on having, let's see, just a little more material here. It's a high spot right here. Okay, that's about as close as we're going to get it for now. I still got one little spot here where it's right here. All that time you spend doing sheetrock work at home pays off. Okay, almost all Almost all. We got one little spot still here. Patience, patience, patience. Oh, finally. Okay. What I'm going to do is get some thick CA and just tack this up in the front so that this joint is perfectly flat. That a little bit of space that's going to be underneath there, I'm going to fill in later. That's not an issue. I want to get a straight line on the top here, and then I want to bring that back piece in and make a little doubler for back there and back there. This will still be unattached, and then I can get my glue underneath. This is the best way I know of to get this all in, and it's still glued to the table. Those really good uses. One of those nail file, Bud McKnight kind of turned us on to this. This is a great place to just cut one on an angle and get right in there and get that joint nice and smooth. Get it roughed out on the other side. I like to do these joints one at a time, just get them roughed in, rather than wait till the end and have 50 of them to do all at once. Now with that joint nice and solid, you see this can still move. And I still need to fill in. You're always gonna have this because you've taken two saw cuts out of that piece. If you don't have to fill this in, you know what's happened is you've basically made a banana. Okay, so what I've done is pre-glue both of these sides just a little bit and get a piece of whatever thickness this'll be, it looks like about a 32nd, and just cut a little strip for right now just to hold that in position while I make up the doubler. And the trick is to see what thickness of wood this is to fill in that gap. And it's a little less than a 16th, so what I'll do is take a 16th, give it a couple of swipes of sandpaper, that should do it. Now it's just a question of, again, just doing a little dry fit, give it a couple of swipes. I want a nice, decent fit in there anyway. It's just a little less than a 16th. Okay, that looks like a reasonably decent fit. Glue one side first. And what I'm trying to do is keep it even on the inside. Let this piece hold it right in position. The new Classic Q104.3 423, you are coping in the afternoon, Don Henley. Now I'll just get a number 26 blade, trim that off nice and flush. These little, I guess nail files is what they are. Real handy for getting in these little corners. Again, I like to work one edge at a time, one joint at a time, not to get too far behind here. That doubler away. I want to make room for the doubler that'll go right across there, across that joint. I always like to make one part of these doublers. You see how I've captured that angle? I've also captured that I'm confining the horn. Just rough this out, and I want to capture this angle up here. I want to have part of this will actually be 64th plywood, and then it'll be confined in 16th balsa. I think you have the best of both worlds. If you just make it out of balsa, there's a chance it'll crack. If you make it out of 16th plywood or whatever, I think it's unnecessarily heavy. This way you kind of have the vibration resistance of the balsa and the strength. And of course the grain is going front to back here. Just trim this out. So once I get a pattern here, then I'll have a pattern for the other side also. Okay, I can come back just a little bit here. Saver is Once you have the final fit on a piece, make yourself up a pattern. In this case, I'm going to make a pattern for Bob Martens anyway. Important, grain going front to back, and it also will help confine the horn and keep oil from sliding through this. I want to get a reasonably nice fit around the horn. Now again, the C grain with the grain going exactly the same way. As soon as that kicks, I'll trim it off with a brand new number 11 blade. Now I also bevel all the edges just to kill a stress riser if there's any chance there's one. And by the way, keeping this from cracking at these points is really, really important. And by doing it this way, you use the minimum amount of weight, and it's really strong. That grain is really going in the right direction. Now I use thick CA to attach this, and I want to harden the whole part with thin. Basically, I still have this piece loose. The next step here is going to be, well, I'll do the next one off camera. I'll just repeat everything I just did here on the other side, and then we'll get ready to put the belt crank mount in. Now the first thing I want to do, I want to get, and this is just a rough thing, I made up a little pattern with 64th plywood. I want to get the grain going front to back in the plywood. Now what I want to do on this piece, I want the grain going, we're trying to make it twist resistant, so I want all the grain going top to bottom. It doesn't seem like it would be that way, but that's the way. The idea here is to get the grain to counteract the twisting motion in any way we can. Actually, I'll take all I can get. Now it's always easier to do it this way and then sort a part out rather than trying to saw two parts and then glue them together. I did a couple of test fits. I always want to get the plywood right laminated on the plywood. Get thick CA along all the edges that touch. And that'll be the end of having these two doublers in place. Now what I try to do is just hold the side with a little ruler to hold it in place just so it doesn't dry with a ripple in it. Like maybe we'll tack this in. Again, just getting the glue to go underneath there is fine because we're going to build a fillet from both sides. And that's all that needs to happen right now. This side can still move. See, I made up the little belt crank support here, and what I did is I made it up a little bit undersized, and I've just marked the arrow just when I make the piece on plywood to extend that out a little bit so it's going to be a nice tight fit. It'll fit in there nice and tight.
Now, I know this is going to be oversized, so what I'm going to do is just trim this off and then just with a sanding block, just get that so it's a really nice press fit right in there on the plywood doublers.
This is one of the little pain in the necks that I run into is little pin dots of the CA. It seems like when it kicks off, you get these little, I call them splatters. Oh, you son of a gun. Anyway, I like to try to keep that up as I go now. I want to just grind, made this a little oversized. You see it won't fit in there? Just block sand the side in. And put a little bit of a radius on the bottom. Now I'll make sure I get that little radius on the bottom, that little radius, because I already have a glue radius in there. I don't want this sitting up off the piece. I want this actually to become just like a little wing spar. Oh, we're running out of glue. I want to make sure I get this in with the radius down. Make a little cap with a little recess in it just to confine this, just in case for some other reason, who knows, 20 years from now this bell crank bolt doesn't start walking up and down. There's just a little piece of plywood with a little recess for the wire. Now I replaced one little former there, put the little cap over the bolt. Redid all the glue seams inside here real nice. And Karen came home from work and she's sick as a dog, so I don't know how much more I'm going to get done here. We've been really battling this cold. Now I want to get a piece of quarter grain 16th in here just to give that a little bit of torque resistance, build that and complete that box from where the motor would end. I'd like that torsion effect to go right back actually to where this is, to the wing spar. Now before I put that piece on, I want to get a little piece to lock this in here. The idea here is to connect as much of this nose to as much of the wing as possible. And what I want is all nice tight fits like that. Now I want to put the cut in the front of this that'll match the front of that wing so it's a nice tight fit. And see, that piece will fit right in and capture the leading edge to that front former with one little joint. President Nixon!
an easy way to make the inside fillet on these guys is just take out the piece you cut out of the root rib, and I'm going to mark it up here. Where's that pin? What I want to do is mark how much of this actually will be the fillet. The fillet will be from there. Let's see, we can't go all the way to the back. We can end it here. Now what I'll do is I'll take a piece of quarter inch balsa and trace that and make what amounts to be a half of an I-beam rib out of that piece of wood. Now this is what, we did this on the Griffin, I guess we did this on all the planes. I want to get the grain going as straight as I possibly can. I'm not sighting the center of the wood, I'm trying to sight the grain. So in effect what I want to do here, get the grain exactly the way I want it. I can leave it a little oversized. Now what I can do is just bring this down a quarter, roughly a quarter of an inch. Again, not exact. We're not, you won't see this part. This is more for vibration absorption than anything else. And now I'll make two of them because I'll need one for the other side, and I can just, I guess it's almost like making I-beam ribs here. And I'll save this part, and I can extend this a little bit so I can do the final trimming in. Always better to leave it a little bit longer, and I can get ready, well, just strip it down first. Now here's the trick. What would happen if you stripped out each piece individually here, and then you went to put the reverse curve in it, either with a sanding block or with the Dremel, however you decided to do it, you would find out that you get about here and it would break. The trick way of making wood fillets that's always worked well for me is leave the first fillet attached right to the piece of wood and then put the reverse radius in here while it's attached to the second fillet. And if you do it that way, you find out you don't break nearly as many. The trick is, and let's see if we can avoid breaking one, let the first one be still attached. As you're grinding out that reverse radius, the other one is holding it steady. Get an idea, I'll final sand that out with a little, I guess a copper tube would be fine for that, and a piece of maybe 150. But actually letting this piece hold that in position made that a whole lot easier. And if you think I'm kidding, go try to do one the old-fashioned way of just having that in your bare hands. Now always easier to do as much of the sanding before you put it in place, because it's in such a confined area, it's hard to get an internal fillet to sit nice. It's just in a very awkward spot. So if I can get as much of the sanding done now, this will add a tremendous amount of vibration absorption. All of the planes that I've made that have had these inside have been real good about not cracking the fillets, even in crashes. Even planes that have had the wings ripped off them didn't have the fillets break. And the wood, of course, is a lot lighter than any other equivalent material that I know of. And that's, let's see if you can see it. That is a reverse, an inside, one inside reverse fillet.
and try. Now see, I had to put a little relief in there for the, oops, just cracked it. But it doesn't matter, the bell crank mount and a little piece for where the stringer comes up. Now also, the inside, I need to radius because in here I've already built up a little bit of a glue fillet. Now the whole trick here is to push it down, let the wood conform, it's soft wood. This adds about 3 to 4 times the footprint area that you normally would have of a fuselage side just running into a piece of wood. It really does spread the vibration out real well. Yeah, I had to do a lot of little cut and pulling to get around this, get a nice reasonable fit, but always good to leave the sawdust on here. Sawdust will help. Ooh, there it goes. That'll kick it, baby. That's a good way to do that. Now I got a brand new number 26 blade and I'm just trying to pick up all the little spots where the glue, there was one, another one. Some of them are bombastic. This is why you don't want to glue this with any more glue than you have to. There we go. Now before I cover up the table with the pad, I want to make sure I get off all the little dots of CA and all the sawdust that winds up staying inside where the fuselage used to be. I gave that a quick look at alignment. I think that's going to be real good. No, I always rub my hand on the blanket right now. In fact, any spot I see that has a little blob of CA is one over here. See, I need a brand new blanket now. This one's getting full of CA. Bunch of little spots. Anyway, I'm going to have to be real careful. There's one up there. There's one here. Otherwise, these things wind up putting all little dings and dongs in the bottom. Now I'd say that was one hell of a long day. Got a good session in today. Anyway, tomorrow we'll finish bell crank mount, some reinforcements in here, the internal fillets on the top, arrow shaft tail, but for right now it's sleep. Hey, see you tomorrow. Thank you.
Okay, the first thing today I want to do is get the bell crank, the little support, kind of a repeat of what we did on the bottom. Then behind here I want to get the motor mounts are spaced about a 32nd off the wood so I'd have clearance. I want to get some wood packed down there and build a little bit of a former behind here. I have the same pattern I used on the bottom, and I can just see it still needs to be a little bit bigger. Now again, I always make it just a little bit oversized. Trim the side that's over. I want this a nice tight press up against the plywood. Get that little cap on there. Of course, if you try to do this with your finger, guaranteed your finger is now glued to the plane. I always soak any plywood part, soak it with thin CA, just to strengthen it up a little more. I'm gonna make the same kind of this piece we don't need in here anymore. I want to make the same, and I won't do it on camera, I'll just save a little tape. Same fillets we did on the bottom in here, and a little former back here. Now I always try to pack some thick CA down into that joint. And when I get to do the outside joint, then I can pack glue in from the other side. This hardens up the wood a little bit too on both sides. In between the mount and this, there's probably a 32nd of an inch of space. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to cut a shim that's just a little bit oversized, maybe a little bit thicker than the motor mount. And I want to slide it right in there. I'll coat it with epoxy and slide it right in there so that in effect I'll get that joint that the motor mount is actually touching the wing in as much of a footprint as possible. And I want to get it just a little bit oversized that it stays in there of its own accord. Now what I'm going to try to do, I'm going to try to heat this epoxy up. I don't know how successful this is going to be. I want to warm this up with a hairdryer, and I want to take one of those little sticks of wood. Of course, I want to. This is the same epoxy we use to join the wing to the body and everything. I want to stand this on its nose and let it kind of drip down in there so that I can get an inside fillet on this with the epoxy and with that piece of wood that's going to run the length of the motor mount. Now I'm just pushing that epoxy right down in there, but I know. With the viscosity the epoxy is right now, it's not going to get where I want it to be. But once I get enough of it down in there, the whole idea is to connect the wing to the height, the fuselage to the high point of the wing, and once you've done that, the rest is going to work just fine. Now the heat will let it flow, oh yeah, it'll let it flow in there a lot easier. And the last thing I'll do is just shove the sticks down in there while they're soaked with epoxy. Now see, this is getting soaked with epoxy real good. Once you get that heat on there, it just turns to water. That's what I'm looking for. There we go. Just like when you glass a wing.
Now I'm going to show the last thing is shove that stick all the way down in there and just break it off. And I know I've got a good bond. Now I can do the same thing here. After about 10 times of shoving it down in there, I know I've got epoxy coating the whole stick. And I'll get a Q-tip with some alcohol on it and clean that area up. That'll do it. Then I can build it. I'll build that fillet off camera. That's just going to be the exact same thing as we did on the bottom. Save a little tape.
You know what I did? I took a Q-tip and got in that little box and smeared some epoxy all inside with a Q-tip. Now I want to build just a little, what amounts to be a little former on here to cap this off.
Okay, the fillets are in. We're ready to move on. Next thing is to make up a 19-inch arrow shaft. 19 inches. That's one of the basic differences between a Seafire and a Spitfire is the longer tail moment arm. Now step one is I'll take a Dave Brown arrow shaft, cut off a 16-inch piece. Now it leaves me an inch on one end. That's going to go up by the flap horn. And I also am going to need about 2 inches to put my joint, my slip joint, and my back, the adjustment for the fine tuning in the back. I want to have at least that extra inch. Now, if I didn't have that, I'd allow an inch on each end. Now, I need to take two of these over there to the drill press and drill them out to 093. These come with very undersized holes. These are the Dave Brown ends. Hey, you want to always make sure you use an 093 wire, because sometimes you can pick up a piece of 075, it feels the same. Not a good choice. 093 only. So I always put the bend in a wire, leave it a little oversized, and then after it's bent, otherwise you'll never get that bend, then trim it off with a parting wheel. The critical thing, you see how tight this is? This is really a good tight fit. That's really important. I've seen guys drill this out with like a 100 drill or a 102, and this is all sloppy and they fill it with glue. This should be a really tight fit. Just to drill a 093 hole just a little bit past where the end of the arrow shaft will be. Always important to make sure this amount, at least some amount of that wire is sticking up out of there and that it's a good tight fit. Now I can bend this end. I'm leaving myself the thickness of the pliers here and that should come out to be roughly an inch. It's not really important because I'm going to do the fine tuning up at the other end. I always put a couple of notches in the end. I just do that with a parting wheel, just so when I slip the eyelet over here, I can put some safety, I call it safety where it's not really copper wire on there. It's a redundant system to make sure these joints don't fail. Always have the push rod ends facing outside the circle. In this case, what I did is I put the arrow shaft point, the piece sticking out on the bottom, so if this becomes part of the part that's visible when we have the pilot installed, I don't want to see that lump up top. Now the next thing is I want to put some thin CA all over this and wrap this with carbon fiber. The best thing to do is tack it up at one end
and then just wind it on. That seems to be the easiest way. With just a little bit extra up around that wire spur that's sticking out, I always try to cover that. Or you let that CA cook off, and I'll trim this off and sand it down just to clean it up. Okay, once that CA kicks off, I can grind that right down. Really good, another use for these, whatever we're gonna call them, Bud McKnight sanding sticks. They really do work well. It's a good use for it. Again, I'm just afraid maybe when I do the cockpit, I'll be able to look down and see this, so I'm trying to make these a little prettier than I normally would. Now, a critical thing to do right at this point in time, this is the side that's going to go up into the flap horn. I'd like to mount this in on the flap horn and see that it has the same amount of play in each direction. A lot of times, this 90-degree bend needs to be an 89-degree bend. And what happens if you put that in and you don't have the same amount of play in each direction, you can build in a bind into the control system.
Let me show this in real life. All the pusher rods facing outward. Now see, there'll be a mean average, but you're always going to have a little bit of slop. And I want to see, I have more slop in this direction, and the slop is not the correct word, more play than in this direction. So I don't want to take a chance. I'm going to build in what amounts to be a little bit of bind. And you don't want to go bending this end 14, 15 times. The slightest little tweak here will do it. Okay, now it has about the same. And of course it should sit right in the middle without any kind of binding at all.
Now I want to lay out this end. We're going to wind up, let's see, exactly at when this is done, of having 2 inches of material to work our joint in. So this end is just, first off, I'll put the straight end in here, get that little piece of wire bent up. What I do, I took a little bit of a flat, just a very slight flat on both sides of this wire that will be the wire joint. And I want to marry up the two flats just slightly. Now what that does, it gives me a little bit better soldering joint. I won't have a figure eight, I'll have more of an oval when I'm done. And I want to wrap that with copper wire now. I put the little notches in here, and of course I want to make sure I have the right amount of clearance here when I actually go to put this in the fuselage. I left it a little long so it doesn't rub on a hatch or any of the blind nuts or anything that are in that hatch. And this will give me a good, if I really have to, if push comes to shove and I have to adjust this push rod length, I'll just have to stick a soldering iron in here, heat this joint, and then readjust my neutral, let it cool, deflux it and clean it, and I'll be ready to go again. And we did use that trim feature on the Spitfire, so no reason to abandon that. Now I need to cut a little piece of aluminum tubing here. This is going to be the bushing so that I can set neutral. And then when I pull this off, I'll pull this off before I actually saw this. Boy, nice blade, Wendy. How about buying a new blade once in a while? Anyway, this will allow me to get fine-tune my neutral. That'll give me the same amount of slop up and down, and just before I soldered a bushing on, the final little piece, I'll take that off. That'll keep me in neutral for all the time that I'm doing the alignment. Okay, next step is to hook up the push rod here. I want to safety wire this, copper wire it, just as a redundant system. Again, all the push rods facing out, just as another redundancy. I also made sure I don't have an unequal amount of play. I think I put that on the tape already. And that'll be ready to solder up. Now, it may seem like some of these redundancies, you know, are really unnecessary. You have a solder joint and
whatever, you really don't need this? Well, if you never need it, that's great. But if you do need it, it's really nice to have it.
When I'm in love with somebody else,
and as always, be sure to deflux the joint. I'm going to clean this up and I'll get a little chain lube on it. Then we can get ready to work up at the other end.
Pretty serious work on like the steering column.
Now what I want to do is I want to get the tail ready. What I need to do is just put a couple of dots on here and press these hinges right in. Now the slots are already there, they're just tissued over. And what I do, I mark it off. And you can actually see the dry spot in the tissue. It just puts the slots right in without making a mess out of it. And when we get the tail ready, we're ready to put the tail on. Hey, it's moving right along. One, in getting this tail installed, is I made little wedges, and I want to lock the flaps in neutral just by just the pressure of these wedges going in there. Put one on each side, then check the center line. Now see, I can just put that little wedge in place, get both of my flaps neutral at the same time, which in theory they should be exactly the same. Let the wedges hold that in place. Now I can put a block of wood under here. That'll hold the push rod up and I can start laying out the tail. But I always want to go back and be able to reference that I'm not losing neutral, because if you line this up and this is down or up, gonzo, gone. The easiest way to deal with this that I know of while we're working on it is just have a block of wood in there. That holds that up. But the first thing I need to do is drop this down into position. I'll take the hatch off and cut away just enough of the formers that this will drop down into position. All the formers are just a little bit oversized now. See, now I can just put a little pen line on that, then take a Dremel tool or a knife and just cut a little channel, just enough. I don't want to notch that out any further than it has to be, and I know how far down this will have to drop to get the full clearance. Okay, now you can see with the horn in place, since this is going to rest up there, I can put a little mark here to get my height. And then as I chip away at those formers, the push rod will drop down, down, down. I don't want to take any more than necessary yet, because it just weakens the body unnecessarily, but that gives me a good reference point right there for working on this. And I really don't want to take even a 16th more than I have to. I'd like to have that just as if I had sanded that notch right in the formers. I can see I have to come down roughly half an inch. I'll start at the back one, and of course the front one will be a lot less. I'll just start notching that in. And these are the little chunks I took out just to start this. And now as that drops down, little by little by little, I just pick up whichever one is the one it's hitting on, lower that just a little bit, until I arrive at that. See how much more I have to go? This way I get a really nice neat channel right down the middle there. Let's see how close. Whoa, right on the money. Oh, it's almost like I did that off camera.
I didn't. Don't worry. I don't do that kind of stuff.
Okay. I'm just going to take a little tube and sand those nice and smooth. And you might think from time to time, well, what the hell is he sanding the inside of the body for? What is he sanding the inside of the filter?
You know what? There's a famous poem, a famous saying, and I don't know what it is, but it ends in a punchline, the gods see everywhere, and they certainly do, believe me. So does my wife. Come on now, somebody out there must have a copy of that poem. Each unseen and hidden part, for the gods see everywhere. Don't we have any poets watching these videos? Somebody with an education? Beside me, of course.
Okay, I think you can see roughly how much clearance is there. And I allowed myself just a little bit extra here, just in case I want to maneuver this around. I don't wind up that I have to break that former away to do that.
Actually, what we'll do is once the tail is glued in place, we'll run the controls through their full travel and make sure we have enough clearance, we're not binding on anything in there, and then of course give a final oiling to all the pushrod connections, lead out connections, and whatever. But this is basically ready now to lay up the tail. Now, one of the things I remember doing, and in fact a couple things have happened that you'll really enjoy this. First off, I was maneuvering around, dropped an X-Acto knife into the wing, and I'm gonna have to make a repair there. So of course I got in klutzy mode. Then I tried to press that little piece of aluminum tubing in here and found out it was a little bit oversized, got it frustrated, wiggling around and jiggling around without realizing I have eyelets that are exactly the right size. And what'll be able to be good about the eyelet is it'll give me, when I go to take it out, a little room to grab it with pliers and pull it out. Now in the past, getting that piece of tubing off has been kind of a pain in the neck because it's already in there and you can't move it around, you can't get a hook on it or anything. So having that little eyelet in there will be a little bit of an upgrade. And that's the whole purpose of doing everything. The whole purpose is try to make each one and each operation just a little bit better. So let's get that tail ready and lay it out.
Now see what's nice, that little bushing will hold that in place. I'll have a little bit of a lip that I can pull that off when it comes time to remove it after the tail is in position. So maybe that's a good little idea you can use too. Hey, some of these things you just invent as you go along.
Now the beauty of lining up a flat tail is you take the block out, you drop it in. The fillet helps hold the alignment. Double check that the flaps are in neutral. And now I just have to check that the elevators are in neutral. Now I have a couple of ways of doing this. One is I can sight it, of course. I can look down the end. I can check it in reference that way. Edges look even. Now I just need to know. Need some kind of weight.
Now see, we're looking right down. This side is just a little lower than this side. So I'm going to take the sanding block, take the high side, and just dress it off just enough so it little by little by little, and not fast here, because otherwise you wind up with the whole thing getting crooked. Just enough, maybe four or five swipes at a time until that tail sits perfectly parallel to the wing.
I hate to do this and then be off this way, so I really like to take it, this block of wood, by the way, is a good tip, one step at a time. I like to get this dimension next and then get the hinge line to hinge line last. Any kind of a weight just to keep that in position.
See, now what I try to do is do like a hold my nose right by the where the spinner point would be in and drop down and see which side kind of disappears first. Now it looks like it'll need one more swipe on this side if I'm looking at it right. Now don't fool yourself by having, see I have the weight not in the middle here because I've been trying to take out the twist in the fuselage. The fuselage is sitting here and I don't want that to take precedence over the fact that this is sitting here. Not explaining that correctly, but anyway. Okay.
I was trying to explain is I have a little bit of a wiggle in here because I'm sitting up on a pad. I'm not sitting on a hard table. I really should be on a hard table. So what I did, I just jacked up the wing, put a couple paper towels under the wing, folded up to stabilize this. And of course, I want to make sure to wait now with that stable is right in the middle. Let's see what we have now.
Yeah, we still need to go more.
What I did, I put an IBM card in one side, and that kind of leveled it out. So what I'm going to do now is mark this side with a pen and take the thickness of an IBM card off of just underneath where the stab is on that side. Just where the stab is touching, I'm just going to, just that part, just the slightest little bit. Now I need the thickness of an IBM card. Now that's where I need to remove the material from. Just the thickness of that pen line will even be too much. I'm holding my thumb here as a backstop. Now, of course, this gets a lot more involved if you have an airfoil tail, but for a flat tail, this really takes a lot of the building time out, making it a lot simpler. Let's check it now. Again, it's always better to take a little less and do it over and over than just hog off a giant piece and then have to do the other side twice as much.
Now let's see if we can eyeball this. As we drop down, see it disappear equally on both sides. Both sides. I mean, within some reasonable amount, say the thickness of a pencil line, that is real good.
It's real handy if you have an 18-inch tail moment on, because everything is 18-inch, the rules are 18 inches. In this case, we're on a 19-inch. And the idea is to get it when it's, now we're gonna do this with slow dry and epoxy, but to get it just a hair. We haven't glued this yet. Okay, and then take a final check. Nothing changed. That everything's in neutral.
That we're losing the tail on both sides real equal.
It looks like it's good, it's blocked in. Let's mix up some slow drying epoxy and get this guy going.
The whole idea here is to have a little bit of extra working time. You know, we're at the end of this building session, and one of the things that I just want to remember is when you get this drying, I have some other stuff I have to do tonight, but always give yourself a little extra time. I've tried in the past to use 5 minutes or whatever. It's never a good investment, because what I like to do is while I'm doing today's mail, I can sit and babysit this tail. And the babysitting of it, just watching it, nothing changes, or nobody walks into the shop here with a six-pack of pizza and drops it on the plane. And we almost had an accident the other night here. There was too many people here. But anyway, from this point on, it's really starting to be an airplane, and I really am looking forward to doing that cockpit. That's coming up. Get the blocks on, the cowl, everything final sanded out. We're really starting to make an airplane here. And I know it's been a long time coming, but there's so much more coming on this. I really have a lot of really what I hope are going to be useful ideas. Okay, I've got a nice thick bead of this on here. I want to leave just even a little more than I need, let it drool out, and then I'll wipe that with alcohol as the final thing.
See how nice glocky of a bead is on there.
Now half of the good luck or bad luck of this whole job is gonna be hold this in dead neutral. I know the flaps are in neutral, and try to get it laid down real straight on the first shot. And now you get to know if you're lucky or not. Sounds like a Dirty Harry thing. You feel lucky today. Okay, the jar is in the middle.
Actually, the fuse is really rubbery, right up to the point that, this is not totally neutral now, right up to the point that you put the X members in, which will be one of the next steps. Okay, let's get an idea of what we have. Now, before that kicks off, let me get a couple of Q-tips under here and just get that beaded in. And now we're going to start what amounts to be the babysitting operation.
You know, I can get in there with a Q-tip, wipe that epoxy, make a nice little fillet there, put a bend in the Q-tip, get up in here. For right now, make sure I have a real good joint. Having that hatch there is really an asset.
Okay, and then for the next, this usually within 15 minutes is hard to the touch, but I'll constantly monitor, give it about every 5 minutes and monitor that hasn't moved. It's real nice now if nobody shows up in the shop here for the next half an hour. That's really a big asset. Check down to make sure the flaps, we haven't lost neutral on the flaps. Make sure we got neutral on the controls here on the elevators. Now while that is drying, I'm just going to make myself up some more exhaust manifolds. I got that rudder that may or may not need another coat of silver. I'll have to look at that real close. The top block is ready. The canopies are here. The pilot's here. But we've got all kinds of cool stuff. This has really turned out to be a nice project. Anyway, more of this stuff is coming up. Hey, I hope you're enjoying this. I hope you're getting some ideas, some ways you can improve your own building, your own kibitzing or whatever. We actually got this together in a shorter time than I thought it would. Anyway, that's the end of the tape. I hope to see you on the next tape and get everything lined up straight. And I hope this tape has helped you figure out a nice, reasonably easy way to do that. Now, I always try to end every tape with something of interest besides airplanes. In this case, this is Walt Prey's beautiful ship. I don't even know how to describe the beautiful paintwork, workmanship. Beautiful. Now, speaking of canopies, and we will be doing a canopy real soon. This one, oh my God, is that a lot of work. The old MiG, he had a nice canopy. He had some nice detail work on that plane, too.
Hey, nice shirt. This guy thinks he's Arthur Godfrey here.
One of the first BJs, Black Sunday, and one of the planes I don't have a lot of pictures of, basically, because the tail horn let go. About 20 flights into the 20, maybe less. Broken control horn, lost plane, all that work. And that was the plane that we wound up using the tail and I think the flaps and the killer bee. And what shop would be complete without a complete assortment of Vico wheels? Now come on, guys.
I didn't take mine off. I forgot. I'll go back a row.
As back he goes.
Spin the wheels. Come on, spin the wheels.
Good. Oh dear.
Roger Wang.
Well, you can start breathing again, Wendy. They finally decided to move your airplane.
They'll move it back. Don't worry. At least they're making a cliffhanger.
Well, they are, aren't they?
Well, the last thing they'll do is put Whiteley's friend in the front row.
Yeah, well, I think they've walked around. I think they walked around and said, well, these are the ones that's going to be on the front row, and now we'll make them sweat for an hour. Until we move them around a little bit.
I wish I knew the guys. I would take Mike Rogers' plane and have him put it about four rows back. He'd have a heart. He'd commit suicide.
No.
There might be a death in a family.
Would you say that this is the best two or three front rows you've seen for
absolutely
a while?
Absolutely. You know why? Because everybody is getting better at finishing. It's not a secret anymore how to do a finish. Yeah. Part of it is, you know.
Well, you've been telling them.
Well,
you've been
there's I counted them before. There's 15 planes in the top three rows that I know the guys have watched the videos and sanded, you know, and been on the phone and helped each other.
They are.
And especially you guys from New England, they're just super.
Improves the breed, doesn't it?
Everybody gets ahead of the game.
Yeah.
You know, and it's a shame that everybody can't live near guys that are willing to help. I'm sure in Australia it's no different.
Yeah.
But that's beautiful. I don't care what anything.
Thank you.
I mean, if you took, I was going to take the prop, put on my plane, quick, they're coming down the rough.
It's the wrong color.